Welcome to the September 8th City of New Ulm Park and Recreation Commission meeting. We'll begin by reviewing our agenda for today. We have a guest here, Mayor Boisman. Welcome to you. Thanks for joining us. Next item of business would be to review and approve the September 8th meeting agenda.
Offer the motion.
We'll have a motion.
Second.
And we have a second. Any discussion on the agenda for this evening's meeting? Hearing none, all those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carries. And beyond to item number three, the minutes from the August 11th meeting. Would ask for a review of those and then a motion to approve the minutes.
I'll make a motion that we approve them.
Okay. I will second.
We have a motion and we have a second to approve the August 11th minutes. Any discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carries. Item number four, the August 2014 Department Activity Report. We'll take a moment to review that, and if there's any questions for Director Schmitz or Assistant Director Horman, please let them know of any questions or comments you would have. Any questions from the commission? Hearing none, we'll order that as filed for the month of September. On to item number five, City Council meeting recap. Director Schmitz.
Thank you, Chair Fryer and commissioners. As usual, there were two City Council meetings since our past commission meeting. And the August 19th City Council meeting saw some action related to park and recreation, including the City Council awarding the Minicon Park Water Access Site Improvement Project to low bidder MR Paving Incorporated of New Ulm. Additionally, to retain Bolton and Mink Incorporated to assist with construction services and construction administration of the project. And finally, to authorize proceeding with alternate one, which is to pave the upper parking lot rather than simply leaving that as gravel. Additionally, the City Council accepted the donations that you recommended they accept, and they authorized Hermanfest, a number of items related to Hermanfest, including the fireworks and closing of Center Street Hill during the fireworks and amplified music in the park and so on. Finally, they also authorized to beginning the process of soliciting a request for proposals for Johnson Park Master Plan. And then the September 2nd regular meeting of the City Council saw them declare unused, worn out items from the department as surplus so that we could move forward with disposition. And that was it related to Park and Rec in the past two City Council meetings.
Okay, any questions for Director Schmitz?
I have a question. Is Hermanfest going to be an event that will be an annual forever kind of thing?
Chair Fryer, Commissioner Carlson, and commissioners, the Herman Monument Society organizes the festival, and their plan and desire last year was to go ahead and do it again annually. And they, as far as my understanding goes, I attend some of their meetings. They do have a desire to maintain that as an annual festival in September. And also, in partnership with the city, the Park and Recreation Department, and City Council authorization for funding of the fireworks and so on. So that's my understanding that that's their goal for an annual festival.
Okay, any other questions or comments? None. We have had, there was no old business to discuss, so we're on to new business. Item number seven on our agenda, donations. Director Schmitz, would you like to review the donations?
Yes, thank you, Chair Fryer and commissioners. We have a number of donations offered to the department, including for the annual Herman Run sponsorship during the first Saturday of Oktoberfest coming up soon, our Herman 5K. There's two separate $150 donations, one from Mike's Collision and Tire Center, and a second $150 donation from New Telecom. And then for German Park, a $100 cash donation from Joshua Wilkening for a paver stone honoring Honey Wilkening. Two German Bohemian Monument flower pots have been offered by Joel Albrecht, valued at nearly $43. And then two additional flower pots on the other side of the German Bohemian Monument in German Park, offered from George Glotzbach, additionally valued at near $43. And then for our scholarship fund that the Park and Recreation Department administers for people who apply for scholarship funding for programs and activities, $75 cash from Beth and Lane Sletta in memory of Aura Sletta, and $25 cash from Janelle McRae in memory of Aura Sletta. For the dog park, $63.42 from Citizens Bank. And then for the outdoor fitness equipment being installed in Harmon Park this week around the playground of the Mega Tower as part of the Heart of New Ulm's February 2013 pledge to donate up to $100,000. There's $10,000 cash from the Hearts Beat Back Heart of New Ulm project and their Lose It to Win It challenge. And additionally, $9,104 cash from the New Ulm Medical Center, Alina Health, also for the Lose It to Win It challenge. We've got a list of thank yous for the mayor to proceed with after the council accepts these donations. $19,567.42 is the value of cash donations, and $85.86 is the total value of non-cash donations. I recommend you forward them onto the City Council for their acceptance.
So moved.
Yeah, we have a motion.
Second.
We have a second. Is there any discussion on the recommendation on the donations? Hearing none, all those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carries. On item number 8, 2015 fees. Director Schmitz.
Thank you, Chair Fryer and Commissioners. This is the annual time of year that we review our fee schedule. It's a rather extensive list of various fees and charges. It normally comes out to the commission for review in September, and we would expect the commission to adopt or recommend the City Council adopt them at the commission's next meeting in October. Sometimes the commission has decided to accept them in September rather than reviewing them for a month. So that's your option today. I'll begin with the overview, which includes philosophies related to keeping fees affordable for everyone, also keeping up with the inflationary costs of expenses, recouping true costs wherever feasible, passing costs on to actual users, consider partially subsidizing youth activities rather than adult activities, and there's been a long history of that in our community. Regular small increases are favored over few large increases. Let's see here. A couple of items of note. In the parks category, we've added a rental category for the amphitheater and band shell. In the past, that has never been available for reservation. We just haven't had it in our system. The only thing in German Park that's been in our reservation system has been the large pavilion. Mm-hmm. And so you'll see a couple of other additional opportunities for reservations, including, you know, as I mentioned, the amphitheater and band shell combination. Also mini shelters. There's a number of mini shelters throughout our system. And occasionally we get calls from neighborhood groups or small groups to have a party to actually reserve one of our mini shelters, either at Minicon Park, North Park, North Market Park. German Park has a small mini shelter on the north end of the park, and Lincoln Park. So that is something we put into the proposed fee schedule. Here's an item with Junior Baseball's annual use of North Park. We have an arrangement with them where it's a flat fee. It's a lump sum fee for normal annual use of the ball fields at North Park. They have a range of games in approximately the 120 game range. And as you may recall, they were not paying any fees whatsoever a few years back. And we brought them into the fold of user fees. And we have slowly been bringing them up to a market rate by the amount of $400 annually. And what we've done is we've kind of taken a look at the retail price involved with the number of games they use the park. We have individual day game rates. We have individual nighttime rates. And then we have a day-long rate for multiple games in the same day. And then we have a tournament rate for them. So as we do our analysis, we're getting close to the market rate. And we put in the normal $400 increase here from $3,200 to $3,600. And I'm recommending we cut that increase in half. There will be a change recommended by me and the department to go a $200 increment at this point from $3,200 up to $3,400 as we near the threshold of a market rate for their use in the park. Indoor facilities, we're trying to keep up with the consumer price index. We've got a lot of 1% to 2% increases. We have some admissions where we go by 25 cent increments because we don't want to have to deal with pennies, nickels, and dimes when you're dealing with the wading pools or the walking track and Herman Monument and so on. So what we do with the daily admission rates, where we'd like to move up in quarter increments, 25 cent increments, we make that increase every 2 years. Mm-hmm. So this would be the every other year for us to make that 25 cent increase. We also have a proposal in here to institute a TOT fee. In the past, children 5 and under are free with a paying adult to a number of our areas, including the indoor pool and some of our other areas. And in keeping with a user pay system, I'm recommending that we consider changing that to have a half price rate for youth ages 2 to 5, and it actually would have been 3 to 5, I think.
Yeah.
Ages 2 and under would be the free with a paying adult. I guess we have a typographical error there. So a TOTS age 3 to 5 would be admitted for a half price rate, and children 2 and under would still continue to be admitted free with a paying adult.
What precipitated the change from 5 and under free to now going 3 to 5 that we want to charge them?
Well, my recommendation with that was to have a discount for the youth, but also to have a user fee. It's something that the commission can think about and discuss. There's kind of that threshold in this age group from, 0 or 1 up to 5. We've got some 5, soon to be 6-year-olds that put as much stress on the swimming pool or a play apparatus is a 6 or 7 or 10-year-old child. Children 1 or 2 sometimes, that's where they start walking at 1. Mm-hmm. And I feel that there's kind of a difference between a 5, soon to a 4 or 5-year-old versus an infant or a 1, 2-year-old child.
Because we certainly wouldn't want to discourage them from bringing that age group in, because now we have to pay a fee for them, where prior to it, with an adult, they had no charge.
Correct.
I don't know.
I think extending that to the tots is a little bit extreme from the user fee concept.
I think that's a great discussion for the commission. At what age, you know, is a tot no longer a tot? At what age does a user put stress on a system?
Or at what point are we ceasing to provide a service and trying to make money off of it?
One of our philosophies is to maintain our system and, allow users an opportunity to assist with maintenance of the system. So again, that's something new, something for discussion. You may or may not want to make a decision today. It's entirely up to the commission. Continuing down the list, we've got, modest inflationary increases for memberships. So those are kind of the items of note, I would say, in discussion for next year's fee schedule.
Got a question. The user fees, do they go at all toward capital account, or are they put into maintenance and then allocated to those particular areas where the fee comes from? Or is it just put into one big pot?
It's put into the Park and Recreation Department's operational account for maintenance and operations.
You mentioned something about recouping the cost
of maintenance and operations.
But you didn't mean the capital cost.
No, correct. Okay. Yes, Commissioner Bourne, no. Capital expenses are separate line items that the commission and the council votes on.
I have a question on a couple folds here. First of all, opening up the band shelter and the amphitheater at German Park, are you concerned at all about the usage of the band shell for other things besides music? Because right now it's shut to the public during the day. Am I correct on that?
Commissioner Carlson and commissioners, the band shell is the upper portion in which you have to climb steps to get up top. Mm-hmm. And it's a very unique facility. It sometimes is used in conjunction with the amphitheater. So we're just suggesting that we provide it in our reservation system. If someone wants to have a wedding in the amphitheater, they should be able to reserve it and know guaranteed that, it's theirs for the time period.
Sure. I understand that. Like, for instance, if you were to put on a play, you need to have the facility in guarantee that it's going to be there. So I get that. But what I'm kind of worried about is, I don't know, like somebody going up and using the band shell for purposes other than music. Let's say there is parties there, water balloons getting tossed over the side, or, odd misuse of what it was originally purposed at. Or when you open it up for rental possibilities to the general public, are you going to be really specific about what it's going to be used for?
Commissioner Carlson and commissioners, we do ask the renters what they're planning to use it for, whether it's a birthday party or a reunion or a wedding or so on. Presently, people use it free of charge, first come, first serve, and we have no control over what actually is going on there, unless the law enforcement community comes by to check on it every once in a while.
So it is open to the public?
Yes.
Okay,
I
didn't realize that. I thought it was always locked.
It's not locked.
How many times is it used in a season, roughly?
It's used, I would say, very few, Commissioner Rockvam and commissioners. I wanted to put it in the system so it's available for reservation. Mm-hmm. You know, I don't see a huge influx of reservations or a great revenue stream here, but I'd like to just continue to formalize our system and provide opportunities for people to guarantee use and for us to promote its use.
Mm-hmm. I think that's a wise move, simply because if somebody wants to do something, they want to be sure to have a place to do it.
That's right.
Yes, and presently the pavilion is the only place down there that we have reserved for people, okay. The large pavilion. We will continue to have community concerts there free of charge, you know, the Monday night concert series that the commission and department offer, and the occasional Wednesday municipal band concerts.
Mm-hmm.
Those are reserved through us and booked through us. We will continue to have those. But we have occasionally had theatrical requests for reservations.
Oh, yeah,
and,
we've had
new
MLC actors. Has had plays down there, I think, a couple of them, haven't they?
Pardon?
MLC has had a couple of plays down there,
yes,
haven't they?
Yes, MLC.
You probably want to also have control of things you don't want happening down there, like somebody starts pole dancing or something.
Actually, there were square dancers up there one day when the municipal band went to get chairs, and we returned them after having our concert, and there were people square dancing up in the pavilion or the band show.
The band show.
Mm-hmm. I think that's great.
Show. Yeah.
So we were pretty shocked just to see someone up there, much mm-hmm. less having a good time.
Yeah. And that's part of our suggestion here also, is to promote its use. The band shell has maybe not gotten significant use since its renovation in the 90s. And if there's anything we can do to promote its use and to provide reservation opportunities, that's kind of what our thoughts there are. In addition to that, the mini shelters. You know, we don't expect a huge revenue stream, but if someone wants a small gathering in that north mini shelter in German Park, you know, for a certain time period, or North Market, that's got one of our larger open shelters, we want to be able to provide a reservation system with a reasonable fee to reserve those for private gatherings.
Okay, then with the reservation fee, are you going to have a posting system on those facilities so that the general public will know? Because we've kind of come to be used to the free and open system, and all of a sudden, you know, if there's a conflict, that we can notify people of reservations? Or?
Yes, Commissioner Carlson and commissioners, we have a two-way system with that. We have posting capability, but we also have a receipt that the user has, a full-blown receipt document that if there was any question, you know, with two groups there, the group with the reservation receipt document wins.
But there's not going to be, like in a restaurant, where they put a reserve sign on the table.
In some,
if somebody would come along and reserve the bandstand, you could give them a sign to put up there.
Yes, in some of our shelters we have that type of a sign system.
Okay.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Maybe one more question, Director Schmitz, on the fee schedule here. Have we ever been able to do a comparison with other municipalities or communities for this sort of fee schedule? Sometimes it might be helpful. We can sit here and discuss what a fee should be for a tot or a baseball field for an hour, but do we have a reference point for any other community so that we can understand kind of what that market looks like outside of New Ulm?
Yes, we do, Commissioner Fryer and commissioners. We have a peer market group that we review aspects with regularly. And sometimes it's a little different to find an exact match. You know, for instance, the Recreation Center, there's not a lot of them in our local peer market group that have a field house and an indoor pool and exercise rooms and so on and racquetball. But we do regularly check with our facilities group in our peer market group for comparisons on fees and rates and memberships and programs.
And you feel we're competitive and fare well compared to our peer group?
Yes.
Hmm. Really?
Maybe something to bring here for the commission to be able to review and then be able to share with the public, because sometimes we don't know what a great deal we have until we see what the alternatives are around the region or other communities. So maybe if you can do that for this meeting. Other thoughts from the commission? Comments?
Well, my comment would be that I think in general, especially New Ulm is so unique and so special that we value and encourage, you know, physical activity and outdoor experiences that we can look around to see what other cities are doing for their rates. But I think that if we really want a positive usage, a rate needs to be as low as possible to keep people motivated to doing it. Mm-hmm. Yeah. You know, like the tot usage, tots do exist, but they also are members of very young families that are just starting out in life. And I personally know a lot of people that do park and rec things because it's so cheap. It's something they can do with their kids to get out.
Economical.
Yes, exactly. And if we start adding fees, it can possibly hurt usages too.
The only fee that anybody complained to me about this last year was the wading pools. They think that's exorbitant, which I don't even know how much it is.
It's $2.25.
How much?
Look at the fee schedule.
It's $2.25.
Oh, for a kid to go in the wading pool?
Mm-hmm.
You're jesting. Mm-mm. Wow. Okay.
I think you have to balance that user fee with the common sense and the reaction of parents to the fact that they've got to pay for their little kid to go in there. And like Finke's reaction, a lot of them think it's ridiculous that they have to pay that for a little kid.
Wow. German Park, when we had the pool down there, Tuesdays and Thursday afternoons were free.
Free.
Other than that, it was a nickel, mm-hmm. but that was back in the 1950s.
And that was
and before.
That was 60 years ago.
I know. You guys, kids pay $10 to see a movie.
Yeah.
They pay $2.25 for a coffee.
Really?
It's $2 to entertain a baby is a deal. It's not that bad.
Oh.
I also want to make
That's
a comment.
I never got to go to the movies when I was a
kid. Yeah.
I'd also like to make a comment about the fee system and paying your way. I guess I personally don't have any problems. I know that young people can't afford this or that, but a lot of times they do afford things that maybe, you know, they could put a little bit towards their child going in and swimming or something like that too. So sometimes we just have to make choices, and our facilities need to be kept up to a certain standard. They just do. And after I've sat here for like almost 2 years, I realize how much everything costs. You know, the paving down at Minicon Park just boggles my brain how much that's going to cost and those kinds of things. So all that has to be paid for.
Well, maybe we could raise the fee on the tots to $3 then.
That's not what I'm talking about. I'm talking about the swimming fee for the indoor pool, for one thing. You know, having three- to five-year-olds pay something.
Chair Fryer.
You started with, go ahead.
About approximately 10 years ago, when we went through the first rash of cuts, of LGA cuts, there was talk of closing a wading pool because something had to be cut. And the community band together and raised several thousand dollars to keep one of the pools open. And one of their comments was that we should institute a fee. And so we did. And we started, I think it was maybe a dollar. And it was at a dollar for a few years. And then it went up to $1.25 and $1.50 and $1.75. So probably about every other year, it increases by about a quarter. And that's that's the history behind the fee at the wading pools. Most of the parents out there and those that were fundraising said, hey, we have to keep the pools open. We don't care if we have to pay, but we need to do what we can. So we had to come up with something, so we tried to make it as low as possible. the pools do cost a lot of money to run and upkeep. And I feel that, you know, $2.25 or $2.50, I think, is proposed to go up to, is still very, very inexpensive. But that's, you know, that's your decision, what you want to recommend.
Is there a figure as to how much money that brings in?
Yes.
Yes, we've got it right here on our spreadsheet in the budget. We bring in about $7,000
from the little kids.
In revenue, $6,000 to $7,000, and it costs between $35,000 and $55,000 a year to keep the two wading pools open. So let's just say it's 40 plus grand a year to keep the wading pools open, both of them.
And is the majority of that fee labor of the staff that exists to maintain it, as in cleaning it and then the lifeguarding of it?
It's about $20,000 in labor, and it appears $7,000 or $8,000 in supplies, and a similar amount in utilities.
Well, I think this is a healthy discussion. What I'm hearing is wanting to have the balance between having a well-functioning park and rec system and facilities, as well as making sure we're thinking about the people we represent. And Tom, I and Assistant Director Cheryl, the philosophies, I think, in the overview are great for us to continue to reference as we're thinking about fee schedules for our community. Whoever put those together, I think, at least from my standpoint, do a nice job of helping remind us what do we need to keep in balance as we think about fee structures for the community. Any other questions or discussion on this item? And then we'll need to make a decision on whether we table this for 1 month and come back and take action in October, or whether you'd like to send this on to City Council with a recommendation today.
I would like to get some phone calls from the people out there, find out what they want, get some reaction on this.
I agree. I'd like to see it tabled, and then perhaps Clay in his article can announce that the whole town of New Ulm should call Park and Rec.
We call their commissioner.
Tom and Cheryl know what their passionate opinions are. They should let us know.
And all the commissioners and their information is listed on the website.
City website, yes. The packet and commissioner contact information is on the city website.
Any other discussion or thoughts on the fee schedule for 2015? I'm hearing interest, at least from this side of the room, of tabling it for a month.
I'll offer a motion to table it until our next meeting in October.
I'll second it.
Okay. I don't know that we necessarily need a motion for that, but is everybody comfortable just waiting a month?
Sure.
Okay, let's wait a month, and we'll have it back in the packet. In the meantime,
I'll withdraw my motion.
Thank you. Meantime, why don't we take the opportunity to discuss this with neighbors? And
she's going to withdraw her second.
I'll second too. Okay, thank you. Well, keep those ready though. We'll need one next month.
Okay.
Okay. No. On to business item number 9, 2015 preliminary budget. Director Schmitz.
Thank you, Chair Fryer and Commissioners. The City Council will see the 2015 preliminary budget at their next City Council meeting. You can see from the action form, there's a little bit of an overview in which we're not projecting or recommending any new significant or large additions to the system. We're continuing to focus on repairs and maintenance of existing facilities and programs. You see the preliminary budgeted revenues are 3.165. Preliminary budgeted expenditures are 3.437. The difference is planned to come out of fund but balance. Significant project in 2014 that will not happen is the Johnson Park and Field restrooms and accessibility renovation. We do plan to have that ready to go next year with plans and specifications. Just a reminder that our fund, Fund 215, is a special revenue fund, and we are not part of the general fund of the city. That we have our own checking account and savings account, and any money we don't spend on an annual basis stays in our fund, unlike some other government systems. You see our fund balance is quite healthy. The state auditor recommends 30% to 50% of your annual budget, and we're up in that 50% range. Some of the expenditures recommended for next year include continued picnic table replacements at $15,000, continued master plans for the Minnesota River Parkway and Johnson Park of $20,000, continued tree planting and tree replacements for $10,000, German Park repairs, $20,000. The last field at North Park for irrigation at $12,000. Repairs to Herman Heights Park and Playground at $70,000. Wading pool pump replacement, $4,200 to keep the wading pool pumps working so we can circulate chlorine and filter the water. The Johnson Park, I'm recommending that we up it from $150,000 to $200,000 for the ADA compliance and the restroom project. Minicon Park, as we all know, is proceeding and hopefully will be constructed and completed this year. There may be some bills that we have to finish paying for next year, but the state is paying $250,000, $250,000 from the DNR. And approximately $80,000 from the city. Parking lot repairs at some of our parks, including German, North, and Miller Parks, need crack filling and seal coating. We did the Recreation Center, Civic Center, and Community Center this year. Repairs at the Rec Center, $19,000. That's the revenue. Our budgeted revenue expected coming out of the Recreation Center because of increased use. The Recreation Center has seen increased use and increased revenue annually for the past 6-7 years. But we project that to come up. We've got $30,000 set aside for repairs at the Recreation Center, $16,000 for a UV sanitizing system for the spa. When we get the hot tub spa full of bodies, we've got a real challenge to keep it safe and sanitized. Fitness equipment replacement, $13,000 at the Rec Center. Tables and chair replacement system-wide, including the Civic Center. Kiesling House repairs of $10,000. And an open shelter, possibly at Highland Park, $15,000. So
the $10,000 at Kiesling, is Kiesling used for anything for during tours or anything?
Commissioner Rockvam and commissioners, the Kiesling House is still under lease to the Grand Center for Arts and Culture. Okay. The city owns the facility and has a responsibility to maintain the facility. And the Grand Center for Arts and Culture leases it. I think they're using a lot of storage in there now, and maybe not a lot of programming. Okay. But that's the latest on the Kiesling House.
Okay. Is their fee covering what our expenses are for that?
No.
Their lease fee?
The lease agreement is a utilities agreement where they have to pay the utilities, I think it's the first $50 of a minor repair. But there's not, other than that, there's not a significant revenue to the city from that lease agreement. They have to pay the utilities, heat and cooling and water and so on.
Sounds like there's an area where you could put a user fee instead of the TOTS.
It's certainly something that can be looked at, yes. So then continuing down, you see the city manager's letter to the council with some information about the levy. And then you've got many pages of the Park and Recreation Department Fund 215 in the various divisions, the Administration Division, the Parks Division, the Outdoor Wading Pools Division, the Recreation Center Division, the Civic Center Division, and the Community Center Division.
I have a question.
And then I want to point out, after the numbers, you've got, I think it's a 5 or 6 page document. It's on page 32 of the packet. And that lists the functions of the department. All the buildings that are maintained and facilities and programs that are maintained. So that's the budget packet. Again, no need for any action today. Action may take place over the next few months. This is preliminary, and normally the City Council adopts the budget in December. So you've got plenty of time to review it, think about it, and if you have any desires to modify the preliminary budget, we can discuss that, and the City Council will have ultimate say over all these aspects.
Okay, looking for questions or comments?
I have a question. When did, you know, we did the restoration of the Harmon Park shelter. I thought we were going to do the parking lot in a second phase. That's not in here yet?
Correct, Commissioner Prochnick and Commissioners. That may be something we can put into the 2016 budget. Yes. It was kind of one of the thoughts was 2 years after the renovation to consider doing the parking lot.
Now that we know that there's going to be a new high school built, is there any adjustments that will be need to be made within the Park and Rec budget based on the new facilities that will happen there?
Commissioner Carlson and Commissioners, at this point, I'm not aware of any significant issues. I don't know if you're referring to, you know, their athletic development aspects and sporting development aspects. At some point, I know that they're going to be building some fields and facilities up wherever the new school goes. And it could be, yes, that they utilize some of our facilities less. That's a possibility. I do know pretty certain, though, that they're not going to build a swimming pool or a hockey rink.
Sure. What I'm seeing, though, is like fitness equipment and things like that. And I know a lot of things will be transferred from one facility to another, but I would assume that a lot of thoughts about what the future with that high school and how we can adjust our programs and facilities will always be considered. You know what I mean?
Yes, yes. I understand what you're saying, Commissioner Carlson and Commissioners, and we'll just have to wait and see what happens, you know. It could be that they might cease utilizing some of our facilities, maybe baseball, softball, football. We're just not quite certain. Just remember, we've turned away some user groups, including summer collegiate baseball franchises and minor league football franchises and so on. So there may be a change and some balancing that may take place. But there's also a documented lack of certain types of athletic space in our community. There's a lot of softball and baseball teams that can't find enough fields to practice on. Or can't bring in a big enough tournament because of our lack of facilities. So I think adding some athletic facilities to our community will certainly be a help, and they'll be maintained by an entity other than the Park and Recreation Department.
Okay, other questions or items for discussion today with the budget?
I do have one. There is a policy that there's going to be no new projects. I forget how you had that worded in there.
We're recommending no large new additional projects without a outside funding, so to speak.
Okay. I have been talking with people in Goostown, which is where I live, about the playground on the south end. Right now, they've got Minicon Park with basically nothing, and they've got Riverside Park that has some playground equipment. And that ends at 3rd Street. And under the park plan, you want a park within 4 blocks of any house. Well, Goostown residence goes down to 18th. From 3rd to 18th, that's more than 7 blocks or more than 4 blocks. It's
yes,
a long way.
That southeast portion of our community does not have a traditional neighborhood city park playground.
So it's between the railroad and the river, and between roughly center and 18th south. I've been talking to people down there and have located a couple of areas that we could look at, but that would require, if it's to be done in a reasonable time, that'd be require putting it in a budget ahead of time. The timeline for getting something planned and getting something in the budget and getting something made, what is that? What's the normal time period for that? I mean, would I, if I find something that they want to do down there, want to propose it, will it get in the budget for 2015 or 16 or what?
Commissioner Bourne, I would think at this point it may be something that should be considered in the 2016 budget. I think if we spend take our due diligence in planning and crossing all the T's and dotting all the I's with a solid plan, and then get a solid estimate for development costs, I think that the timing for something like that could be a year of planning and a year of funding.
Okay.
Yes. Mm-hmm. But that you're absolutely correct. The southeast portion of town does not have a traditional public city operated neighborhood park.
Other questions? Couple items I would have Director Schmitz, Assistant Director Corman, be on customer service, and maybe they weren't listed because of the dollar threshold or maybe not anticipating incorporating, but they're around customer service. I think I brought up some of them before, but looking at Wi-Fi capabilities in our city buildings or the park and rec buildings of the community center and civic center and rec center, and then the ability to have online registration and credit card processing for much of our programming and fees. So I don't know if there's thoughts from the rest of the commission, but as I understand,
we've got
today,
information on that. Yes, Chair Fryer and commissioners, we have funding in this year's budget, the 2014 budget, and we have hopes to complete the installation of online registration and acceptance of credit cards in an internet-based registration system as opposed to a server-based system. So that's something that we have in the budget and the plans, and hopefully we can pull it off this year as planned.
We have demos scheduled starting this week for that.
And the wireless internet is in the process also to happen this year. We've got the South Arena complete at the Civic Center and plans to move forward with the Recreation Center, Community Center, and the other arena, and those are not huge dollar amounts. Okay. Those are not capital projects.
Excellent. Scratch those off the list then. Might have done already, guys. Any other questions for the budget? If not, we'll have this come back next month for another review. Take a month, and I know there are a lot of schedules, a lot of pages that you have the ability to go through and solicit more feedback from constituents as well as questions, direct them to Director Schmitz. Okay. Next on our agenda, item number 10, system tour. Director Schmitz.
Thank you, Chair Fryer and commissioners. This is just an opportunity for you to schedule an annual system tour, or partial system tour. We've never been able to get through the entire system in a single tour over the years we've been doing this. So, but often the autumn is a time that we take an hour or two to drive around in the city van and look at stuff. So it's entirely in your lap as to what you'd like to do. I'm just proposing the possibility of connecting it to our next meeting and getting on the bus or the van after the October meeting.
Do you want suggestions as to where to go? Or
between now and then, yes. Before the actual tour, I would recommend that you get suggestions for sites and facilities to me so I can try to organize them in a geographical manner.
Minicon Park. That's a big one.
We might have to drive around the bulldozers.
Yeah.
Or drive them. Be a fun
tour. I have dibs on the passenger seat in the front.
Actually, that's your place.
Who's
the passenger seat? Car, your place, Gar.
My?
The
Why?
Passenger seat in the front. Yeah, we went to the training. Weren't you up there?
Oh, I gave it to that. Oh, he had a bad back.
Oh, that's
Do
right.
Do you remember?
Mine's
right.
Mine's terrible. Oh, golly.
Yeah. Bad attitude.
Oh, mine is so bad. Oh, I need suspenders.
Talking about seat assignments, so I'm assuming there's an interest from the commission. What about the date? People be comfortable with October 13th?
Oh, I thought it was September. Wait.
October might be better because if you if we go into November, December, we probably have larger clothing on. It'd be more cramped in the van.
So that's Columbus Day. Does that mean anything to the city? No,
it
doesn't
did
mean
to
anything.
Columbus.
Okay. Just the U.S. government closing down on that. Okay, gotcha. Mm-hmm.
Anyone else? October 13th, will that work?
Sure.
Yeah, sure.
Okay. Director Schmitz, would you like, I see there's an action sheet on this. Would you like us to take action on?
Yes, if you'd like today? To set an actual date and time, we should agree to that now.
I'll offer the motion for the 13th of October after the regular meeting.
Second.
We have a motion and a second for our annual system tour on October 13th, right after our regular meeting. Any more discussion? All those in favor, say aye.
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 Opposed? Motion carries. Item number 11, survey update. Director Schmitz.
Sheriff Fryer and commissioners, the only information I have on that is I'm just kind of putting the finishing touches on it and the final details together in hopes of getting that out in the next couple of weeks. That's all I have for an update on that at this time.
So the plan would be for that to be sent out to the community, not to come back here until we would see the results, the outcome, is that?
Yes, I think we're ready to send it out by U.S. Postal Service mail to a certain number of households in each ward, and then also make it available online. And additionally make more hard copies available at a number of different facilities, including the Recreation Center.
Okay. Any questions or discussion on the survey? Item number 12, we did have a work session within the past month, and that was dedicated, well, actually it would have been prior to our last meeting. I apologize. I missed our last meeting.
Yes,
that's
you
why
did.
It seems so recent. We did have a work session, and I think most of the time was dedicated to the survey tool development. So thank you for those who were able to spend some time working on that. I think we ended that with handing it off to Director Schmitz with a good tool. Director Schmitz and I did talk about maybe having another one scheduled here sometime this fall. So if there would be interest, we'll need to select another date, set an agenda. I think one thing, depending on the timing of the survey, might be good to have a work session to review the results
exactly.
And have the time to be able to do that and really discuss it. I know one other topic that was brought up at our last work session was potentially to invite some of the larger associations that have a relationship with the Park and Rec system. To have them be able to have some time with the commission rather than have them depend on a survey response on behalf of junior baseball or hockey association or you name. So we could maybe invite some of those association leaders to join us and just understand their needs and
That's
interests.
Right.
And
and what their projections are, like you say, the projections they're going to have down the road, fitting into budgets and their modus operandi.
Toby, were you considering having them come to the work session or to the meeting, to the actual commission meeting?
I think the initial discussion was to a work session.
To a work session? Okay.
Is that?
That's fine.
Okay.
Yep. No, I just wanted to know for sure.
Any other thoughts on a follow-up work session around education? Maybe we'll use, I know in the past, I think we've used your calendar tool to solicit dates and times that work for the commission. Maybe we can work on that, setting something out a month or two.
Right.
That'd be good.
Okay. Hearing support for that.
The last place we had, the location was wonderful, too.
Location was wonderful.
Mm-hmm. And the coffee was good.
The service. On to reports, item number 13, Director Schmitz.
Thank you, Chair Fryer and Commissioners. Some of the projects that have been completed or are extremely close to being completed is the playground replacement at North Park, the irrigation of two of the three fields at North Park. The Nels Park Water Tower is online, is my understanding, and the site is under restoration and has been seeded, hydro-seeded, and so on. Lighting at both the skate park and Riverside Park's basketball court have been completed. The pavement sealing of the starting ramp at the BMX park was done. Picnic tables have been assembled that we purchased earlier this year. The ice compressor, one of the three compressors, the last remaining original ice compressor has been replaced at the Civic Center. The brochure is out in your hands, the Autumn Winter Program brochure. And just this past Saturday was the Herman Fest 2014 that the society and the city and others partnered on. And our recycling bins have been distributed throughout the system that we partnered with the Brown County on obtaining these recycling bins through a grant. Projects in process, which means purchase orders have been completed, including some tree planting. Buckthorn removal continues with a number of volunteers. The outdoor fitness equipment to be installed at Harmon Park
tomorrow
through the Lose It to Win It program, Hearts Beat Back, Heart of New Ulm. Minicon Park water access site contract is being signed as we speak. And we're anticipating construction in October. And you're aware of the survey and master plan work and the 2015 budget work. Aspects that are still on paper and in plans and in proposed budgets include the Johnson Park and Field accessibility restrooms, the ticket booth replacement at the football field, the parkway master plan along the Minnesota River, tennis court resurfacing in the parks. I anticipate the Herman Heights Water Tower coming down sometime soon or this winter. We do have some work to get done on the Kiesling House before winter with the exterior. Zamboni replacement for next year. One of the two Zambonis at $125,000. Burr oak blight we're taking a look at. We've got burr oak blight in some of our parks. South Nels and Herman Heights, we're taking a look at that. Some improvements at the disc golf courses. The retaining walls on Center Street at Herman Heights Park are still under study. And a few other items you can see. The Friends of German Park are also continuing to look for about $250,000 to get started on the amphitheater replacement. No Eagle Scout projects at this time, but we anticipate some starting soon. The Bicycle Club continues to look into planning for bicycle-friendly community status through the League of American Bicyclists. And there's a variety of different opportunities for individuals, groups, and businesses to sponsor programs and facilities in our department. End of report.
Then just one reminder, too, that this coming Saturday, September 13th, is the day of play taking place at the New Ulm Civic Center. The day of play is a partnership project being held in conjunction with MLC, the city, and the Hearts Beat Back and the Newell Medical Center. So that takes place this Saturday from 10 a.m. to 2 p.m.
Cheryl, do you need commissioner volunteers for anything on that?
You're certainly welcome to come and volunteer on Saturday. They did send a notice out, I believe, some time ago asking for volunteers. I'm not sure where they're at with that, if they need any more. Many of their volunteers are the student body at MLC. Oh, yeah. They lead a lot of the activities, and hopefully it's a great turnout.
It's free.
And it's Tom? Free.
Tom, could you explain under the announcements the bicycle club looking for or into bicycle-friendly community? Being new on the commission, I haven't heard any discussion on that. What is it? How are we involved?
Commissioner Bourne and commissioners, this is the New Ulm Bike Group, the New Ulm Bicycle Club, looking into gaining status through the organization of the League of American Bicyclists. There's, I think, three different levels, gold, platinum, silver, levels that you can earn related to how friendly the community is to bicycling. I know Mankato has one of the three statuses. There's a lot of great information on that website here, bikeleague.org. It's still kind of in discussion and planning phases, and there's no significant dollar amounts earmarked for bicycle developments. But the club is looking at determining what it might take to become the first level, I think, is bronze level.
So these would be suggestions as to what we could initiate.
Yes, like how many bike racks you have in the community, whether or not you have bicycles for sale, bicycle repair stores, if you have bicycle routes, bicycle lanes, bicycle trails.
And this is to attract bicyclists? It gets a rating with a bicycling organization?
Yes, that's my understanding.
Okay, anything else for Director Schmitz? On to item number 14, commissioner reports. Any reports from our commissioners?
Mr. Chair?
Yes, Mayor Boisman.
I really don't have a report, but this past weekend, I was fortunate enough to have a whole bunch of people recognize that I was the mayor. And the greatest compliments went to the Park and Rec. Herman Monument Society was right up there, but the evening with all of the picnic tables that were so well placed, people were saying, oh my goodness, I thought we had to all bring our own chairs, but the picnic tables were there. They could eat, they could sit and talk. The fact of the night that was used, again, is with the cooperation of the Park and Rec Department and the commission, compliments constantly about, hey, we get to start these fireworks at 8:30, not at 10:30. Our little kids can stay up till
right.
9 o'clock.
That's true.
The fact that 4th of July is a busy, busy date. We've got baseball tournaments, softball tournaments. There's probably soccer tournaments all over the area. And the families are stretched. Well, here is almost an empty weekend, and we all got to enjoy it. So thanks for all the cooperation from the Park and Rec Department, from the commissioners that assisted, and of course I accepted a lot of compliments for the city council, even though Pinky knows how much power I have on the city council.
Oh,
but anyway, I just wanted to stop and take a couple of seconds to thank everybody.
Thank you, Mayor.
Thank you.
All right, Chair Fryer, I've got a couple of comments. The circuit bicycle path that is planned to go around the community, up on Highland and then down along the lower area. In connection with the Garden Street bike path, the pathways that are on there now, the circuit requires going up some pretty steep hills and down some pretty steep hills, and that's great for people who are always biking, but The occasional biker can't do it. And I wouldn't even try at my age. But extending the bike lanes along from Garden Street southerly to where Payne Street branches off and goes toward
the brewery?
Hauenstein Drive.
Hauenstein Drive. If the bike lanes could be extended down along Payne Street south, where they would connect to the circuit, and north along Garden Street to near Highway 14, where they would reconnect with the circuit, we would have a lower loop and a high loop.
Right.
And everybody could use it. With the one suggestion that we do not make the bike lanes 14 feet wide.
Hello? Yeah.
But I don't know where this comes. Do we stick that in the plan or a work discussion or what? Anyway, that's my suggestion, that we do that and get a route where Chairman Fryer, you and your kids can go, instead of having them barrel down the Pine Street Hill or the Payne Street Hill, out of control, screaming.
We hope not. Well, thanks for. Did you have one more?
Yes, I have one more thing. Just this weekend, I talked to a couple of people that have had some problems at the dog park. And I think it's something we have to look at before it gets out of hand. One fellow had some problems with his dog's health, took it to a vet, and it had parasites. And the vet says, "Where have you had your dog?" He said, "Well, I take it to the dog park." And the vet told him that it's probably the one place he shouldn't take it, because of all the dog feces that are not picked up, they're spread around, and wow. it's a prime area for parasite. And also another one, the lady was walking along with her dog, and she does that every evening, and they stop at the dog park to rest, and the dog goes in there, and their dog, which is a chocolate lab or retriever, I'm not up on dogs, but it was laying down resting, and a German Shepherd came and jumped it and attacked it and started a fight. The owner of the German Shepherd came running over, yanked the dog off, and then started kicking it. And so it was not a good scene. I wasn't there, but just the description, the owner was of the dog that got attacked was very upset. But it seems to me that no matter what the rules are, if you don't have somebody conscientious there, we're going to have some problems. Picking up the feces or having an area for it, I think we have to look at. And getting the dog owners who backed supporting this bike park or this dog park in the first place, maybe they can provide some volunteer supervision of what's going on there. It's not something, dogs are not all friendly. It's not something we can put a fence up and say, okay, go for it. There are going to be problems. And I don't know if any plan has been made by either the dog park people or us to govern that at all.
I'm not aware of guidelines that have been put in place, Director Schmitz, for use of it. And
well, Chair Fryer, Commissioner Bourne, Commissioners, there are rules, posted rules, that the dog park committee, the dog park volunteers studied thoroughly and researched and have agreed on the rules, and there's the signs posted. There's no enforcement authority down there as far as individuals or groups go. But these are interesting points, and I'll bring them to the dog group. And we'll take a look at it and visit with some of the veterinarians to find out if there's any suggestions they might have also.
I don't have a dog, so I'm not aware of those problems. I don't have any chickens either. But
On that note, why don't we look at the next meeting, October
13th.
We'll be coming back here October 13th, same time. We'll look for a motion to adjourn.
So moved.
And a second?
Second.
We have a motion and a second to adjourn. Any discussion? All those in favor, say aye.
Aye.
We're adjourned.